With your permission, Chairman, the first company to contact us actually has a representative here. I'm going to put him on the spot. Maybe he wants to tell us a little bit about this. Is that all right if I put you on the spot back there? You want to take the time to answer some of the questions?
I don't mind hearing from him.
But I've got a question for Dave. His phone, but maybe on some.
Well, that's why I'm asking Dave. Dave doesn't have a phone. My question to you is, first of all, I don't see a 5% savings here. I see a 5% rate, but I don't think that's.
Present value savings at refunding bonds 5.61% at the bottom.
I see a $19 million versus a $20 million, which is a.
Where are you?
Okay, anyway, I do see your point, yeah. I do see it there. 1% or 1, yeah.
5.61%.
Okay, so that is definitely worth pursuing.
So if she's had a satisfactory or if she's had a dissatisfactory?
Either way.
Either way.
Is there anybody else who could have offered this insurance to us?
This is actually the renewal from Hunt Insurance had come up, and we chose to go with Lloyd's London. They were more cost competitive, and Dave Kerman and I looked up this over quite carefully and determined that for the equivalent coverage, it offered savings to the county.
There should be a letter in your book that I hope there is, and two of them in the last paragraph. We'll see that the recommendation I made was to advise the board of the moderate risks, which PAP has done. To further advise, the agreement is not subject to further modification, which we do not believe that it is. Recommend that the agreement be tolerated for at least 1 year, which is our recommendation.
Just need approval, and we just discussed it.
Well, maybe for the record, the approval.
I make a motion we approve the agreement with Lloyd's of London for stop loss insurance coverage for the inmate medical plan.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion.
Thank you.
Passes
unanimously.
Thank you, Pat. Item number 12, request for additional service from AMEC for changes to the Matt Community Park.
Yes, Mr. Chairman and the Board of Commissioners, I would like for you to consider this evening a time-sensitive issue. This is for additional services from AMEC. This is for them to prepare construction documents for a tennis court complex and a trail adjoining to some additional property at the Knapp Park, also known as the Wallace Taylor property. This was beyond the original scope of the master plan that was approved by the Board of Commissioners. In working through some community groups and other individuals.
Logan, are we ready?
We're ready.
I'd like to call the meeting back to order, please. We are on, or about to begin, item number 17, discussion of Fowler termination facilities, phases 1, 2, 3, and 4.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Good morning. At the last work session, the board requested additional information and in regards to the memory option that the Fowler plant. We've been working with AECOM, who is our contractor on the site, and suppliers to get this information for you. We do have a spreadsheet that has a summary of this information. I think will be passed out to you. And at this time, AECOM is here to present the spreadsheet that again provides a summary of the information. Also, I'd like to be aware that there are representatives of both GE and Avon here to answer any questions you have around the board. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, guys. Mr. Chairman, board members, what's your name?
Nick Cooper. I'm the project manager with AECOM. And I'm here to discuss this analysis that we've done over the last several weeks. This is following the request of the board to develop more information on the various options available to Forsyth County as far as going forward. We're at a very critical point in our operation of the plant. We're getting very close to capacity, and we're about to receive in early August quite a bit more flow from the Lower Big Creek plant to the Lower Big Creek pump station. In order not to lose the savings to the county and also to keep the operation as optimum, we've been asked to proceed with what we call our phase 3 and 4 expansion or upgrade of the plant. Phase 3 and 4 has been set aside in our original contract, our original design build contract, to expand the plant from its 1.25 MGD capacity all the way up to its original design capacity of 2.5 MGD. Now, some of the numbers are going to get very confusing. I'm going to walk through them as close as I can, and please stop me as you need more information. But the current plant is running at 1.25 MGD. We believe that the plant will be allowed to expand to 1.88 MGD. The limiting factor on the plant is really the discharge. We're currently in a non-discharging facility. We go to a drip field down by McGinnis Ferry Road. And during the winter, we're allowed to discharge to the creek next to the treatment plant. But because of the flow, we're going to be approaching the state to allow us to expand the plant. Currently, the plan is to put all the elements of the plant to get it to a full 2.5 MGD. Eventually, we'll be using that capacity. Right now, we expect we'll be at about 1.8 MGD in August. So the plan was to look at several options to proceed with the either the expansion or, as we talked about, the conversion to a new process or a new facility. The original membranes were installed in our original contract dates back to 2001. They were installed in early 2004, and they've been operational ever since. They're reaching pretty close to the end of their useful life. We're now at a point where we're about to spend this next phase of money, the set-aside money, towards either just adding additional membranes or converting the flow, converting the process to a different membrane. And the reason why we think it's valuable to look at this time is that there's a new generation of membranes, both in the hollow fiber membranes and also the flat plate type of membranes. These are two different type of immersed membranes which create a very high quality, reuse quality of water. And they serve very well. They are very consistent, very reliable. This plant can accommodate either of the flat plate or the hollow fiber. Currently, we have the hollow fiber membranes that are produced by GE Water. And the conversion options that we're looking at are to go with a new membrane generation from GE Water called their 500D membrane. It's a little taller, it has more capacity. It has some other benefits, and one that we recommend is what they call a leak MBR that eliminates a lot of the problems we're having right now with cichlid valves. We have valves that turn air into each side of the tank, and they alternate every 10 seconds. Creates a lot of wear on the valves. This new system eliminates the use of those valves. So we think there's a lot of validity, a lot of value to that. The other alternative we're looking at is a totally different system. It uses a flat plate technology. It's not ultrafiltration, but it's very close. It's microfiltration. It gives you the same quality of effluent as the other. And these are generally competitive, or I should say they're offered in competition with each other. So we consider the quality of the water that comes out of them equivalent. And that leads us to looking at the cost differential and also the benefits to the county if they choose to go either of these ways. What I've got is a spreadsheet that shows our initial costs that have to be expended over the next few months. If you look at, we have under the first item, the first series is what we have to do to bring the plant up to a full 2.5 MGD facility. The first line is the influent pump. As I said, there's a few elements that have to change. The only thing that has to be added on the influent side is a third influent pump that allows us to pump the full capacity of our 2.5 MGD plant. So we have a cost in there. We've got a turnkey project to do that, and that is going to proceed under any of these scenarios. So we need to proceed on that immediately, and we've already moved ahead in ordering the pump. The next line is the cost of the membranes and appurtenances, and what I mean there is there are some costs. There's costs for delivering and installing the membranes, and also there's some additional costs depending on which system you use to adjust it to handle these different membranes. So I've got backup for all that if you need it, but ultimately we're looking at the first two columns is just adding the additional trains of membranes. We have 500C membranes, which are the original. They still make them, they'll still produce them, and we can put them in parallel with the others. There's no change in the process. The state doesn't require any modifications to the design. The second option is to have half the plant is 500C and half the plant is this new generation. And the advantage of that is it gets you part of the way towards a complete conversion to a new membrane system. What you'll see as you work down through there is that essentially there's no additional cost to the county. This is set aside in our contract as $946,470. That's a lump sum to us to install and upgrade the plant to take the full 2.5 MGD. So that hasn't changed. There's no cost if you proceed with that option, either of those two. The next two are full plant conversion, and the advantage of this is that it gets you, as I say, it gets you the full requirements for this plant for the next 10 years. You know, there'll be no further improvements to the plant if you make these changes, other than the normal replacement of membranes, which is our responsibility in the first place. So we believe that this is really the lowest cost you're ever going to see for this conversion, and that's why we brought it up as an opportunity. We think it's a very valuable opportunity. However, you have to decide whether there's enough value to make that extra expenditure. We aren't going to see 2.5 MGD right away, and that's something that has to be taken into account. But looking at that column, we still have the cost of the pumps in each case. We have the cost of all new membranes under the two options. Under Ovivo, we're looking at $1,738,000. And for the xenon membranes, it's $1,551,000 for the membranes. Our cost for engineering, which includes our cost of going to the state for permitting, we have a transition cost while we move certain membranes out. We have to start them up and test them. We have to review submittals and we have to be there. So that's $56,000. That's an internal cost to us. And then the cost, the subtotal there is $1,899,000 for the Ovivo system and $1,712,000 for Xenon, or GE Water Xenon. Now, the next line is the AECOM contribution. And what we're doing there is we're saying the cost that we would have spent towards replacing membranes, we would like to contribute towards a new generation of membranes. And although we haven't figured out what that contribution would be on the xenon side, we know that we could offer a full $450,000 for the Ovivo system. And the reason why I'm saying we can't judge at this point how much we would contribute on the xenon side is that the cost of replacing membranes under that new system is quite a bit higher for xenon than it is for Ovivo. So we're going to have to spend over $1 million in the future for the GE Water membranes versus $500,000 for Ovivo. So I'm not saying that we couldn't offer anything, but right now we would have to think about it. We've not really developed that in great detail, so I'll defer saying that those are final numbers, but they're very close. So then you look at the credit that's built into our contract of $946,470, and for the full conversion, the Ovivo cost to the county, this would have to be added to our current contract, would be $502,000, and for GE Water, $765,000. Still very small investment for a full conversion. You're getting brand new technology for the next 10 years. This is current state-of-the-art technology for both vendors. So we think there's a lot of value there for a plan that, that will, you know, generate a lot of revenue for the county. So after you're looking at that, that road, then you look down to the next grouping, and what that shows is we're going to be, we can offer additional changes that will set you up or get you closer to the capacity of 3.5 MGD. Both of these systems can be expanded within the existing tank. The biology is available to get you a full 3.5 MGD capacity. And the net value of that at $19 a gallon for purchase capacity is $19 million to the county. So if you can get the water there, this is the value of having that additional capacity. We're not showing you the full cost because there's a lot of effort that goes into it. The one element that you definitely need is the influent screens. We're having some problems with the influent screens as they are. One of the benefits of these of this opportunity is that we can replace or add better screening at the front end and give you that future capacity of over 3.5 MGD on that element line. Beyond that, the main thing you have to improve is add additional membranes. That's the primary thing you have to improve. At some point, you may have to add increased pumping capacity or increased flower capacity. But with the headworks being upgraded to 3.5, it gets you set up for the future to have 3.5 MGD plant. So that has a lot of value. The cost we're showing, the Ovivo cost was approximately it's about $480,000 screen installed. They are offering $340,000 of that towards that cost. It's an offer because they feel that it provides extra benefit and provides value to their offer. Independently, we looked at the cost to give us 5 MGD, or I should say a comparable flow using the existing screen. We would have to add a third inlet influent screen. We'd have to add grit pumping, blowers, so we could get them to be equal. So in order to be equal, we estimated on $288,000 for each of the xenon or GD water options. We don't put another, we have another line which talks about all the costs that are required to bring everything up to 3.5 MGD. For each of the membrane options, in order to go from 2.5 to 3.5, we would add another 20 membranes for all of the options. And that's comparable to about half of the cost that we're asking for this old version. So if we're looking at $1.7 million, so you would add about half of that would get you 3.5 MGD capacity. So it would be another $800,000 for membranes. There's other costs that we haven't taken into account. There's the pumps that have to be expanded and that type of thing. So we don't have that firm number. That's for the future. But the intent of this is to show you what it would take to get you part of the way towards a much larger. And because of the new technology, we can get there. So then the next row is really just showing the impact to the county of having an additional 1 MGD of capacity. Of course, this assumes that you can get the flow there. And if there are opportunities to divert flow, obviously diverting flow from Fulton County to Forsyth County's plant is a dramatic savings for the county. Virtually every gallon that's diverted from Fulton County creates a dollar of revenue. So a quarter MGD diverted from Fulton County to the Forsyth County plant saves you $250,000 to $300,000 a year. So if you divert a million gallons from Fulton County that's currently going, you save $1 million a year that you're currently spending. So there's quite a bit of, there's a great opportunity if you could take advantage of it. The next line is really internal to AECOM. When I talk about the comparison of future membrane replacement costs, one time in the next 10 years, we're going to have to replace all of the membranes. They typically last 8 to 10 years. The current ones have lasted 8 years. We're trying to get as much life out of them as we can. Sometime in that 10-year period, we're going to have to replace every single membrane. So whether they're brand new or they're just used, we're going to be spending that much. Now, it doesn't affect you unless you took over the operation of the plant. And that's the only value of showing this. Currently, we're showing that the Ovivo membrane placement is less than the other. However, it doesn't affect you until you make that switch over, until you take over the operation of the plant. So it's just there for, as we were asked to get that information. Okay, now the next level is something I brought up at the last meetings, which is we have an opportunity to avoid capital cost outlay under this current conversion. AECOM is willing to finance, either ourselves or through the vendors, the cost of these capital modifications for phase 3 and 4 expansion over 36 months. So we will finance it for you. We will ask that all you do is increase your monthly charges to us to cover that finance charge. We spread the cost of this expansion, whether it's $502,000 or $765,000, over a 36-month period. And the impact is between $14,000 and $24,000 a month, where you don't have to have any more bond money. It's just a change in the operating contract. If we do the financing for the street, which would get you even further along, then it would be another about $24,000 per month for the GE water, and then it would be about $11,000 per month for the arena, because it is a smaller cost of screening. So that's all the numbers we have. Any questions? I know there's a lot to throw at you there, but we have all the backup that you need. Any questions about?
Hey, let me ask you, Mike, what's the term left on AECOM's contract with county?
We currently have 12 years remaining. So 2024 is our contract.
So with an 8 to 10 year lifespan on the minerals, as you said, there will be a change approximately 8 years, which is what you're saying. And then potentially 4 years after we take the plant, there will be another change. Is that true?
Yeah, I mean, obviously the life of the membranes depends a lot. I mean, personally, it depends a lot on the screening. The better the screening, the longer the life. Some membrane plants come in 12 years. We don't really have that much track record. Membranes have not been used for more than.
If you get 12 years out of these, you would not have to change them, which would be good. I'm not knocking you, but I mean, we don't know what it's going to be. If indeed it could, it'd still be good. You wouldn't have to change the membranes.
I mean, that's our goal, obviously. It's to extend it as far as. The day we turn it over, we have to make sure you have that capacity. So whatever membranes need to be changed out at that time, you maintain capacity.
That's what we're
And one other thing I noticed is that membranes have an initial capacity and then it decays over time. So,
how does that?
Well, the impact of that is, you know, whether you have that full 2.5 MGD or 3.5 MGD capacity, at some point it can be retained, but you have to clean them much more frequently. They only last for less, 2 months or 3 months between them.
Do you have any information or any of your other facilities? What do you see on the hollow fiber technology versus the flat plant?
Well, it's very hard to judge one plant against another. It really depends a lot on how much they're taxed. If they're run at near capacity all the time, we see quite a bit of decay over time. You know, in many of our plants, including Johns Creek Environmental Campus, which we're involved in, we did part of that design. That's currently running about 2 MGD out of 15. It's going to be many, many years before they see a significant loss in their capacity. Currently at our plant, we're running right at capacity. We have membranes that need to be replaced, and the reason I haven't done them is to give you an offer that we can contribute towards your conversion. It's causing us a lot of stress. We're having to clean these membranes every 3 or 4 weeks.
Somewhere I heard, I don't know if it was in one of our meetings or before the tour committee or a conference call, flat plate technology is a 98% recovery in another plant that you guys operate versus like 65% on the off fiber.
Well, like I said, it depends on the plant. We have one plant in Oman that we're running and that we designed is 15 MGD. It was in operation in 2009, and we've seen no loss in capacity over those 3 years. And that is really very heavily taxed. They're running at capacity. They have been running at capacity since the start. So they're running.
And they get 98%.
They've had no loss in capacity.
And
98% means that it has to be cleaned periodically, but it recovers virtually 100% or close to 100%.
That's the flat plate technology?
Right. I mean, I think a lot of it depends on the integrity of the material. If we lose integrity, then we lose material.
And in our case, comes from the screen. Integrity comes from screening?
Well, what we find, the integrity problem we have, and we have in flat plate technology, if you have a tear in the plate, you've lost capacity. In the case of a hollow fiber membrane, if the fibers wear out, if they tend to shred, you're losing capacity. We're having problems, and some of that is due to influence screening. We don't know how much to contribute, but that's caused a big problem. And it's, I can't attribute it directly, but it's something that we're currently having a lot of problems.
So we had to replace that.
You started with that
after 2 years.
Well, we started, the first replacements were 6 years ago. Now, like I said, each plant is unique, and we're currently having problems, but if we can be allowed to replace them, we can recover. We need to replace them very quickly. So.
When you started, my notes that I wrote down, you started off talking about 1.25 million gallon a day, going to what I captured as a maximum of 1.88 million gallons a day, and that was all due to the EPD permit for discharge, I thought.
Currently, the discharge permit is based on where we can dispose of the water, and we're still considered a non-discharging facility, so we can only discharge, we believe we can prove to the state that we can discharge 1.88 MPD in the summer at the fields, and we can dispose of all of it from November to April, we can dispose of all of it in the big creek.
But any number greater than 1.88 is tied to whether we get a permit, so it's unknown, and I don't know to what degree it is unknown, but it's unknown whether anything that above that has ever been done good.
Well, all I can say is that the county has applied for a permit to discharge in the Chattahoochee River. It's been held up due to environmental issues. You know, the Shagrag plant is also being held up due to environmental issues. Once we get that permit to discharge, we can run the plant at over 700. But until that happens, we're going to be limited to what we can dispose of on land. And the moment that we can go to stream discharge, and the state is really anxious. The state really wants to get as much water back into the river. That's their goal. They don't like reuse, and they're moving away from reuse because it doesn't return the flow to the source of the water. So we're hoping.
Back to flat plate technology. What we have to put is, are they going to put a new screen in for us? Have they donated the screen? Or are we going to have to purchase a new screen to help the flat plate?
Well, this is okay. They're offering the screen at no purchase cost. We do have to install it. And the installation cost is significant. It's about $140,000.
Is this in the installation cost in your bid here?
It's a separate line item. I mean, you know, both the firms are saying that we can leave the system as is. We don't have to add the screens. And as long as the screens are doing their job, that they don't require them for their technology. What Ovivo is saying is that with the better screening, it'll extend the life, it'll reduce the amount of cleanings, it'll yield better performance of them.
But with the Ovivo flat plate, like I said, if you have a tear or a compromises this technology, you have to replace the whole box plate with a hollow fiber. You can replace one fiber at a time, can't you?
No, the hollow fiber is in modules.
Yep. So
there are either 16 or 22 modules, and it's a sheet of strings. So there's hundreds of strings in each sheet. If a fiber tears, you can probably leave that. If a whole series of fibers tears, you have to take that module out. We're currently at that condition. We have a number of membranes where there's too many strings that are compromised. We need to replace them.
But if Kubota, if the flat plate, one tears, you got to take us whole little wake up the box plate.
Well, yeah, Kubota uses a series of blocks, and if there's a tear, you would lose the whole block. The only thing I can say is that their cost of replacement is very economical. Each block is $350. Each module or membrane under the Xenon or GE is about $1,200 to $1,500. Now, one tear in the block requires that the whole block be replaced. I don't think we can get by with that. So,
but one tear in a hollow fiber, you cannot
break. That's right. You could go a number of weeks and months and years with individual fibers. But at some point, if they had to replace the cost of replacement of a module under hollow fiber is higher.
What's the failure rate with the Kubota?
We've seen some failure rate over in Oman because of some of the industrial waste that got in, it was about 2 or 3% over 4 years. But this is a different membrane. It doesn't require that the membranes are sealed against the plate. They're wrapped around the plate. So it's a different type of technology. Everybody believes that they're improving the previous model with the new model.
If I understood you, I think you said that none of the manufacturers require the enhanced screen that's somehow in this offer. Is that, did I get that right?
It's our intent that the screens, as reconstructed and any additional edit and modification we do, will work for both. Originally, the Kubota screen, the Kubota plates, because they're flat, were able to tolerate more debris. And we think that now they're both going to have the same amount of screening. We don't see that as a requirement for Kubota.
Okay.
They recommend it, but it just extends the life of the
plate.
Well, does anybody guarantee the extension of the life?
There's no change. There's no change. And both of them guarantee it for the same amount of time, with or without the screen.
Or without the screen.
With the screen, they could probably extend it. But the guarantees that we have are only 5 years. I mean, we don't have guarantees beyond 5 years with either of the suppliers. Well, we can get that guarantee. We can get the guarantee, but you have to pay for it.
Are we going to install a new screen, or are we not?
We're going to update. We're going to clean up the screens as they are. The screens have been repaired. I mean, they're not ideal, but we've just replaced all the mesh on the screens.
So what would a Kubota, the flat plate, their contribution was going to be a new screen, so what about now if we're not going to install a new screen?
If we don't install the screen, then you know, you lose the value of their contribution.
But so there'll be no contribution if we don't install the screen?
Right. Well, essentially, you're not paying $140,000 versus...
$288,000.
Yeah, the $288,000 would
help. It cost us $148,000 more to stay with the current technology than it would be to take them up on their offer and get the advanced screen.
Well, and the other thing is that if you do put another screen, a third screen, if it's advanced screen or this screen, you get a full 3.5 mg capacity in the headworks. They're also adding grip pumps, so that gives you full reliability. Right now we have only one grip tank, so that's giving you full redundancy on the grip system, which is also important. So it's more than just adding another screen. They're actually allowing us to duplicate the headworks.
So it's a redundant system?
It gives you a full redundant system.
So for $148,000 cheaper.
$140,000 is what they would need. We got that full price. We have the actual price.
I'm saying that's $148,000 cheaper than the other option for us.
Both of them give us a full brand new grid system.
One for $288, one for $140.
Right.
I guess part of my confusion is that since you're being paid to operate this, any advantage that you say doing it this way or that way or the other way, if we were to modify something, would be an advantage to you if you chose to do it that way. And I don't hear you saying that you're choosing to do any of these extra ways while you have to pay for it, which then makes me question why we would want to pay for it if you don't see it as enough of an advantage to you and your operations within the budget you already have.
I what you're saying is, you know, do we get enough benefit out of reduced cleaning or
extend the life?
Yeah, because it's all on us. You know, it reduces the cleaning, but it's not a physical benefit for you other than it gets you a part of an expansion. And that's the value. So for $140,000, you get the full expansion to the 3.5 MGD on the headworks. That's the value. It's the extra value that you get, not what it saves us on the
cheaper. You've contributed on the Evo Kubota $450,000 for some additional savings that you can share with us.
That's the intent, is that by converting the system, we are willing to try to save and spending money on replacing old membranes with comparable membranes. We can go with a new generation and apply that cost to that new generation and that conversion.
Do you want to run through the second half of this? I think we'll probably some of these things you're probably answering over again.
Yeah. Well, I think one of the most critical things, and I want to clarify this in the spreadsheet, it's not clear. The county is expecting to receive flow from Lower Big Creek by early August or mid-August. So it's absolutely critical that we try to reduce the downtime for the time it takes to get that extra capacity. We can get the extra capacity by retrofitting one of the remaining two tanks. And that can be done fairly quickly under all of the options. What we're not showing here is all of the vendors have offered that they can deliver enough membranes by August 15th to allow us to handle that extra flow from Lower Big Creek. It takes several weeks after that to get it up and running, so we're looking at the end of August as opposed to extended end of September and October. So we're going to try to accelerate that so we can get these membranes in. If we can get an answer very quickly, like today, would be really critical to meet some of these deadlines. Every day we delay is a day that we can't deliver these membranes. So it's important for us because we need replacements, but it's also a value to the county. And then I just want to go back to the cost issue. Keep in mind that a year ago, if we had done this conversion, we were looking at over $2.5 million. Now we're looking at somewhere in the order of $760,000 or $502,000. So this exercise is more than just an idle exercise. This has allowed competition. It allowed all the firms to sharpen their pencils and get us numbers that are beneficial. Dramatic benefit of the county even having gone through this exercise.
So, is your operator offer any input on this?
I believe they issued a letter that showed their recommendation.
What was that staff recommended on this? What are y'all thoughts on this?
I don't know if they're ready until they get through the benefits portion in the second half of the shoot, but they might.
I thought he was summing it up.
No, we were talking about the desirability or savings, and I just want to know what the operator.
Yeah, like I said, I really only have one point. It's hard to argue that you get the immediate benefit. What you get is cost savings of a future conversion, cost savings of future upgrade, dramatically lower prices than you will get 2 years from now, 5 years from now. That's the only benefit I can argue that I think has the value to the county. That's, we think it's a very large benefit to make that conversion. Are you going to get more revenue? Unless you can get more flow, it's going to be the same revenue you get whether you do it or not. But the value is what will cost several millions of dollars would be doing for you to $500,000 or $760,000. So this is an opportunity, but we can't argue that you get immediate value for it. You get ultimate value. That's what I'm saying. And you each have a copy of the letter that our operators issued. They find a lot of benefits with the Kubota system, and they make a recommendation, but they serve at our will, they serve at people at your will. We're just saying that they have an input and they have an interest, but they're willing to work with any system. And they certainly work with the PE water, and they're willing to continue to work with. So we can go through benefits and negatives if you want.
Look at the warranties, is this correct? All of them offer the 2-year warranty except for the Kubota's offer a 5-year warranty?
Well, the 2-year warranty is a parts and labor warranty or parts and materials warranty, and all of them offer a 2-year warranty. In other words, if there are any defective membranes, any defective parts, they will replace them. Kubota has added a 5-year limited warranty. It's a prorated warranty. When a membrane can last at least 10 years, you're paying for that. And that's something that is built into their price. So I don't think that's a negative against UP Water that they didn't do it. Over the years, they found that the value, unless you make it a 20-year warranty, and if you do, those costs are very high. There's very little value to the owner to have a warranty if you never need to.
But you're still looking at a replacement cost of exceeding $1 million on the GP Xenon product, $500,000 on Kubota. So it seems like they're more confident that their cost to add in that additional warranty doesn't reflect in the price of the replacement members.
I don't know whether they include a price for it because
we don't know what the pricing structure is or what their advertising margins are or anything that's put into it. But Commissioner, at that point, 5 year versus a 2 year, it's kind of like the extended warranty you buy on your tire, determined by the tread life you have left. But it still looks like the GE Xenon product in -2 or a million versus 504 for Kubota. And that's saying that that extra warranty is costing us. It looks like it's saving us $700,000. Just based on these numbers.
Well, it does not reflect, we don't see any impact on cost, but we don't know. It would have been $490,000 without the warranty.
Right, you're right.
So, yeah, on a warranty basis, they're almost out of $30,000.
Yeah,
you have a different version than I have. I'm going to try to stay with this. But yeah, on the warranty, they're all offering parts and labor 100% replacement for the first 2 years. You can see the benefits. On both of the conversion options, we eliminate several of the headaches that we currently have. One is the cyclic valves, which alternate between the tanks or between the two halves of the tank. They wear out and they're hard to read. We'd have to get new generation. So we would recommend the 500D membrane because it eliminates a lot of those issues. Also uses much less power than we're currently using. It's a dramatic savings. It's the least amount of power of all the options we're looking at. Kubota system has a number of options. They're offering financing in the case of phase one and two membranes, which we can finance. They're offering free financing. So it's a savings, and it's why your cost is that much less. But theirs is a fairly new technology. They've only got a few pilot units in service. They've been using it in Japan. They have no active plants yet, but they're about to build one in Akron, a very large plant, much larger than this. So they're delivering membranes to that plant. They can divert some of those membranes to us. That's why they're able to deliver. That plant is going full Ovivo. The new generation of technology. And,
when you look at these benefits and cons, it wasn't done here, and I didn't ever even think about it, but if you add it up, when the first two colleges are 7 benefits, Kubota has 15 benefits, and the last column has 7, the cons are 4, 5, 2, 5. Can you explain that?
Well, I think some of them, when we talk about savings, that's already incorporated in the cost savings in the previous sheet. So you see a little bit of overlap there. There are a number of things where the flat plate technology takes less chemical to clean. We don't have to fill the basin with chemical. And this is one issue that, it was an issue down at Collie Creek, which is an indoor plant, where they fill the basins with chlorine and they can't go into the building unless they have a gas mask because it is very toxic. So during the time when they're cleaning, they're not, at least they don't allow visitors there. So the amount of chemicals they use on the Ovivo system is much less. But the Xenon 500D has a much more track record. And that's something that's really important to the staff, to the county staff. So, when you look at the amount of penetration in this market, there's a lot more of the Xenon than the Kubota. Kubota is very competitive. We're using the Kubota system down in Davie, Florida, which is a 4-MPD plant under construction. As I said, I use them over in Muscat in Oman. But they're both very competitive, and they're both very good. And we feel very confident that we can operate either one.
Could you maybe just help us, if this were your plant and you were just providing a service to the county, are you comfortable in saying what direction AECOM, and you see which direction the operator would go, what direction would AECOM go if it were your plant?
Well, I have to defer because we design different membranes for different plants, and the advantage of using Xenon is the plant is currently set up for Xenon. The Ovivo system has to be modified. It does seem to work in this plant. Everything seems to be appropriate. We're looking at another Ovivo plant. I would have more of a problem if we had a gravity feed like we have at James Creek. James Creek is a gravity feed. This one's a pump assist. That allows the Ovivo to have quite a bit more range and permeability. I don't want to overstate it. I mean, obviously, we have an interest because our replacement costs are dramatically less. And
which also results to what our replacement cost would be to take the planter.
Yeah, right.
Do you want
to have? Like I said, we were not here to make a recommendation per se. My operators have a much more stake in it than we do. We just ask the cost.
Do you want to allow Xenon or Kubota to speak to any issues that have been asked?
Yeah, I may have overspoke, and I think the county has the county staff has their own recommendations. I think we should hear from them, and I can answer any questions.
We'll let them both those questions.
First, I think Nick did a very good job of going through the cost and everything. And when we first started looking at this, we were looking for that future benefit of that cost savings. And so a few things have changed over the review period. And like Nick stated, the real potential savings here are 12 to 15 years out for the to the county for the round of replacement after we take the contract back. There's definitely a benefit that appears for the person who's buying replacement membranes in the next 12 years. But back to the county, there wasn't anything getting off the back. So we kept circling back. Once we found out that the Xenon-Cs could meet our future 3.5 MGD expansion that we can get to within the basin, then just looking at the cost, we couldn't find anything that we couldn't do later. So our recommendation, we just kept circling back to what we believe the fastest thing to install would be to stay with the Xenon C membranes. We can do the other things later. We just couldn't find the need to spend, to recommend to you to spend the additional cost, whatever that may be.
Can you help me with a couple of things, Tim? And I appreciate that recommendation. Over the last couple of days, the capacity is increased dramatically on the 500 seats. It is climbing down. Do we have anything to back that up? I asked you, I think yesterday we talked about that. Do you have any data to back up the plan?
Well, the only thing we have is we talked to the supplier, and we could let them answer that. We will have to say it hasn't changed in the last few days. The reduced number of membranes was in the offer to AECOM back in August. So it's not something new that the new membranes can filter more. But it is complicated on how you arrange it and how you do it. But we have no reason, neither does AECOM, reason to believe that that's not still the fact.
When AECOM bought membranes about a year and a half, 18 or 2 years ago, I guess, at max, they had about 8 membranes based on a certain flow. However, if GE Xenon would have told them that this unknown new capacity, it would have only been 6 membranes. How do we know that their numbers are right? And it's really based on what you told me, that we can't just accept the Kubota flow numbers at face value because sales reps are going to say what sales reps say. How do we get past that?
Well, I think we're in the same place on all of them, and it's really what the EPD will permit and allow, and the permeability. I think we've been told that there's a facility permitted in Georgia and Savannah that has a higher permeability rate than what's being proposed here on our membranes. But any of them, it's really designed, and Nick or some of the other people could answer that better. I mean, we don't know. They were buying individual modules. You know, we couldn't answer how that question was asked when they ordered those.
I guess what I'm saying is you told me, and I agreed with you, that the manufacturers needed to back up their sales sheet claims, because we know the cars get 23 miles to the gallon, but when you drive it, it gets 17, and we made the voter go out and bring back data to justify it, or made AECOM do that. I just want to be sure, are they willing to maybe put a bond up, as you had recommended with Kubota, to guarantee those flows?
I don't think we recommended the bonding with Kubota. They may offer it. We've got the same information from both. It's what they submitted to AECOM. We haven't got anything from either one other than their statements. We could review that to see what's allowed in other places, and they would have to answer their questions. But then there is there may be a guarantee that they can give. We can ask them.
We need to. And then the second thing is, am I clear that you're recommending that we spend $305,000
to stay with the 500 cities. No, sir. None of the vendors, after talking further yesterday and today, say that changing the screens are required for the current capacity. It would be required when we go to the next phase to get the 3.5 screening will have to be added for any of them. After talking today with the xenon membranes have basically worked for the last several years with no screening. The screens have been broken and allowed them to foul up and to get into bad condition. So we couldn't say that you had to replace the screens, and they verified that. And today in talking with Avivo, they said the same thing. You don't, while screen improvements would be nice for all of them, Avivo also said you don't have to change the screens to stay at the current permitted capacity. So
is our goal to increase our capacity?
It will be at a later date.
But based on what you just told me, Tim, that the cost then is 305 by 30 to 3.5 MGD. Minus 288, which we have to do.
Well, that's not the total cost.
We have those unknowns, yeah.
Yeah.
I'm just trying to get to, is it better to spend 100 or 200,000 to use 17-year-old technology, or is it better to spend the 500,000 and get a brand new plant that's going to last us another 10 years? That's all I'm trying to get to.
I understand. The technology has been around that long. They've been improved many times, so we're actually more comfortable with the longer life of the technology than the newness of the new style Kubota membranes with no experience on them. But based on what Nick tells us, we've not seen it. He said we're in bad shape, but we've had some trouble with it. We are in bad shape because of poor maintenance at the facility, is our opinion on that. And they have stopped replacing them because they were looking to a possible change out. But with all of that, they've lasted their useful life with less than standard maintenance on them, which reversely was a selling point to their how robust they are. But you could look for the future for the screens and add the screens, and you could spend that money now so it'll be in place. And there is, the numbers are there. It's 305 or 642.
What's the better recommendation? Spend 305 on 17-year-old technology or 642 on new technology with future replacement cost of 500 and more versus 142?
I have a question also, if you don't mind, because it seems like I haven't got my turn yet as well.
You've been a pleasant
surprise. I did hear that if you don't run these things to capacity all the time, they last a lot longer. And that the ones we have now are only 7 or 8 years and they're way overdue to be replaced. So the question is, if you update all the way through to all four phases, and you're not running capacity, I mean, does it not make it more likely these things to run 10 to 12 years?
What Nick said is the stress you put on them can have wear on. Other things can also have wear on. They can start degrading from being in service, even they're not being used. So there's negatives. For instance, a screen that's not needed is going to start breaking down prematurely. If you put the screen in now, it may be worn out in 6 or 8 years. Wait till you need it in 6 or 8 years. That's our thought. You don't put it in until you need it because it's going to start having maintenance issues.
But aren't our screens basically gone now?
They can be rebuilt and have been rebuilt. They
won't provide us. $100 a section?
Sir?
Oh. That's the screens. I don't know. What's it cost to rebuild screens?
I don't know. That's not
anybody used to know.
They were rebuilt 2 or 3 years ago.
Yeah, we rebuilt them twice. We rebuilt them in 2007, and then we just made a rebuild last year. So.
What was the cost?
Well, the first rebuild was close to $200. The second rebuild, I didn't look it up.
So that's going to be more.
I'm sorry.
Be more than the $200.
Well, that's the rebuild. I mean, you still have them there. What you do is take them, in our case, we had to take all the chains, we had to change the spray, and they're also floating.
But based on those numbers, rebuilding the screens at 200,000 versus getting new screens for 140, I wonder.
Now, that's a new screen to get. The 288 is a third screen. Right now, there are two.
No, he just said the rebuild screens in 2007 cost $200,000.
Okay.
And then, so if we're asking $200,000 to rebuild old screens, or $140,000 to get the enhanced new screen, I'm still trying to find out where
We still have to rebuild the old.
So we're going to spend $200,000 rebuilding the old screens, or we can get a...
No, we're still going to have all screens. Let me suggest we would
take those old screens out of service. I mean, you know, our intent is not to run them until we absolutely want. They would be our backup. And because we will now have two grid systems, we don't need to run those old screens.
Will you get two grid systems?
Well, part of the $140,000
is... That's if we go to the Kubota system.
Right.
We get redundancy, so now we get redundancy versus the GZ number, not get that redundancy?
With the current plan, without adding screens, we're not getting any redundancy. So if we add the screens for each of them, then we get redundancy. Yes. And we're not required to have redundancy by the state, but this gives us the redundancy.
But it costs $200,000 to rebuild from what? I'm saying, I'm trying to...
How old was to do $200,000 include installing, right?
That's an operation. We wouldn't have any... That's really what they cost. Yeah. I mean, we wouldn't know.
Yes, it was over $80,000 per screen.
It just sounds like getting the larger enhanced screen with redundancy for $140. Of course, that's $140 for Forsyth County to pay versus $200,000 for Eaton to pay, but I have to tell you, we should be looking at all of these issues so that we're being a good player here. We don't want to shove everything down their throat. It's already losing money. That's their fault, not ours. It's really not their fault. It's the economy's fault.
Well, with a new screen, take us up to $3.5 million.
It'll take the headworks up to it. And then all, like I said, you can get probably to 2.7 or 2.8, just adding membranes. Mm-hmm. Get above that, and you need to add more blowers.
That's an either system, either flat plate or...
You're right. But if we have to have the headworks to do that.
With either system.
Yeah. Once you get the headworks, then it's just a matter of adding membranes underneath.
Yeah.
So there is advantage to upgrade the headworks, but is it required?
There's an advantage, is what you're saying.
It's an advantage. It gets you part of the way towards the 3.5.
This particular plant, I think, is probably our second most valuable asset behind the new water treatment.
But as Jim remarked a while ago, what if we sit here for 2 or 3 years stuck at the 1.8? We don't get any discharge in Chattahoochee. We can't increase it.
Well, we built a water plant, no water pump. We got to pay it for the future. I'm not sure, you know, again, one costs more than the other. One seems to show different benefits than the other. Is it better to spend $305,000-ish to stay with 17-year-old technology? Or to spend $600,000 and get a completely new plant that's going to last another 10 to 12 years.
But if I said this xenon one's going to last another 10 to 12 years with the right flow, there's no problem.
That's right, we're going to have to replace the membranes, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, when you get more.
Right. You're going to replace the membranes.
So either way, we get a new plant.
Well, you don't get a new plant. I mean, what you get is
you fill new membranes.
Yeah, we fill it with new membranes, and to be honest, I'd recommend the 500D because you're getting the benefit of new technology, gets you part of the way towards conversion. So we're looking at 500C versus D.
So we need to get that C versus D.
The C is what's in our contract. I guess that's going to be, I don't think it's an issue, but if you're going to make a move to stay with without conversion, it seems like there's benefit. I'm not sure, Tim. We were moving to the 500C for a major reason, and then we didn't have to.
So
now we have a chance to move up in the technology. If you don't expand, you don't convert.
But the 500Ds, based on...
So we have future conversion.
It's $1 million versus $642. Again, I'm having trouble.
If you upgrade to...
I'm not saying we should stay with Xenon, but I'm having trouble suggesting that we use 17-year-old technology that has had trouble. And I would say that your recommendation would be about C, which I forget about that. If you were going to do it, you'd go to new technology.
I would recommend that we go to new technology. That's the direction that the GE water billing, and
they quit making the CG,
they still make the CG. So many plants out there that use the CG, so they're going to continue to make the CG.
Did you not say one of our last thing, the E's are already on the horizon?
I'm sorry?
E's, 500 E's, or
there's a new generation, I guess, of 500 E that's in this new technology is what they call a deep MVR. It's a different type of aeration system for the, this is brand new. It wasn't even available in March, so we're just now being able to, offer it. So they're all competing to get better, to compete with each other.
Sure, it costs down.
Right. With each year, we think the new generation is better than the previous generation. I guess that would be my thought. Both of the big companies, they're making a big gamble with these technologies work. If they don't, they lose a huge part of the market. So that's the only thing I would say. Even if it's new technology, it's an improvement over the previous. And they would not put it out on the street if they didn't think it would work in these applications.
Yeah, Tim, one more question. If we had to take the plan over, say, 2 years from now, or 3 years from now, which technology would you prefer to run in the plant, CD or Kubota?
If we took over the D's, the only reason we didn't recommend the D's were there was some concern about mixing, and if by us picking the D's, that required them to do D replacements with their other membranes, and I think they addressed that, might be an additional cost to us. So the D's are what we would.
And I also said if you want to keep parallel C and D, we do that.
So we do lose some equalization with the D's, but D's, we agree the D would be better if they're comfortable with it. We are more experienced. We've had consultants in the past do reviews of membrane technology. They've picked the xenon. Outside source, the majority of facilities going in around us are xenon technology. We kind of rely on that a lot when we look at what's going on. We've had good luck with the Kubota at James Creek.
What if John Marshall was your man that's responsible for these plants?
Yes.
Up until we started really looking at these kind of things, I know he's kind of unsure about just as we all are. He was telling us that he liked the Kubota product.
Yes.
Flat plate versus qualified.
Right.
So answering Mr. Addis's question, if we were taking it in 2 or 3 years, based on the D's to the Kubotas, I have to tell you, I can't see where we would spend $1.5 million versus $642 million, knowing that we have to buy replacement membranes in 8 years for another million versus $504 million. If you were to choose the D's or the Kubotas, and it was our plant, we were responsible for all savings and operations costs, which one would you choose?
The operations savings, we would be very, you'd have to really consider that if we were running the plant. It would be a different evaluation if we were running it. And looking at that, we'd want to lock in and see how locked in those prices are. But all of these prices have changed so much. How long can you lock it in? And well, both of them have recently, who will be selling these membranes in 8 or 10 years? There's just a lot of unknowns. The savings is in the future replacement to the operators.
So if we were the operator, what would you choose?
Our people are concerned with, they're a little bit of concern, even though they believe the Kubota's going to work. There's some concern about this new style of flat plate that how they're going to work in 3 to 5 years.
We have no long-term failure rate, or no long-term.
There's some type pilot studies around, but there are none of them in use.
But until now, both manufacturers, pretty good, I guess. They've provided good product, different technologies over the years.
Yes.
In fact, our guy, John Marshall, preferred the flat plate technology
prior to the new style.
Yeah, I wouldn't prefer the Kubota prior to the new style.
Yeah.
But as Mr. Cooper said, they wouldn't put these things on the streets, the 500Ds or E's or the new flat plate, unless it was testing. There's a 2+5 year warranty. I guess, would you choose the 500Ds if this were our plant? Yes, I think
probably. Based on past evaluations, we did a study 3 years ago, hired CH2 and Hill to do an evaluation of which technology to use at Shake Rack. They looked at the old Kubota, so it's different. And they looked at Hall Fiber, and they looked at two, and they picked MemCorp was the first when they did the review. After a visit, they got tossed out. Xenon was second, Kubota was third. Based on that and the previous review and some reviews others, it's really hard to say if this new Kubota membrane may be the greatest thing, and it's definitely has potential. And when it's got more history to it, it may be the thing that everybody goes to.
You don't think $1 million in savings is worth the risk of the warranty that the company's standing behind it that we've been happy with before?
My comment to that is I think everybody remembers Microsoft Vista, which was new at that time.
Well, that's not exactly the same.
Big companies stood behind their product.
I'm looking at GE is a good company, and Kubota is a good company. Let's face it, they both produce good products. Sometimes they have better luck than others. But what I want to make sure that I heard is that we would choose the $1 million project, and that $1 million conversion with $1 million replacement cost over $642,000 with a $500,000. And you don't think the $1 million is worth some risk with the warranty? We know the companies aren't going out. I guess they could, like anybody, but we know the company's not going to go out there and stand by the product if it fails.
I will add another thing too. Your software fails and you get the blue screen of death when you boot. When your membranes fail, you've got customers screaming and hollering, DVDs screaming and hollering, and you're needing and you know what.
I don't think we're talking about a complete plant failure. I think they'll be just talking about the rate that they would have to clean. And I don't think either one of them costs a spill. I'm not sure that's what I'm suggesting. If it doesn't perform
you keep talking about replacement filler. Are you saying that this is an estimate by both of them, by Xenon and Kubota, that we won't spend $1 million in replacements compared to $500,000? I mean, that's another number you can pick out of there.
I mean, is
what kind of record do you have to show?
Given a firm price.
We've had senior officials from both firms.
Why don't we bring them up?
Maybe we could bring them up.
Is that a total replacement for the whole plan?
You may want
to. Okay, both can come up. That'd be good.
Change the question.
Well, the first man went to me and said,
first of all, thank you for the opportunity to address some of the questions that have come up. And clarify a couple things that I'd like to clear up. The manufacturer's warranty that was discussed on the Kubota is a 5-year full warranty. It's not a prorated 2-year plus 3 years. It's a 5-year full warranty, full replacement value. There are 7 facilities in Georgia. There's a 4 NGD plant in Piedmont, South Carolina, using these membranes. 48 NGD in Canton, Ohio. That's going to be started up shortly. There are 2 years worth of detailed operations data available on two facilities that are operating with these membranes. The Kubota membrane is the same membrane that's been in use for years and years and years. The only difference is the configuration of the parts. So the membrane itself is a very tested, very proven technology. The only difference is the configuration of the parts. The Avivo Kubota proposal that we presented, yes, it includes a new state-of-the-art screen. It's a drum screen and a dual screen. It provides much better screening than the existing band screens. But we also included a complete rebuild of the J&A band screens. So if accepted, you would have a brand new screen capable of accepting 5 million gallons a day, plus the rebuild of the 2 JMAs, so you have a redundancy. Currently, if you have to maintain the work on the screens at Fowler, you have to literally stack sandbags in the ditch, pump the water out to work on those existing JMA screens. So you have got a screening problem at Fowler. no matter what you do. You need redundancy, you need the ability to take a screen offline to repair it and work on it. The replacement cost that's been discussed is a guaranteed price. It would be in contract, be tied to the CPI. If we go out 10 years on a guaranteed replacement cost, that's not a, I would hear a number, that's a, it's a number that principals in a deal will stand behind and sign that contract.
The full replacement?
It's the replacement of the membrane media, that's correct.
Over.
All of everything that we're providing. And the other thing I'd like to reiterate is that when we got involved and we were invited to provide this proposal back in August, our price using state-of-the-art SP membranes was $748,000. The Xenon price for the equivalent state-of-the-art B cassette that they were providing was $1,388,000. Our price hasn't changed since August. Theirs has come down several times, $640,000 drop. And we're still here today with the best price we could provide back then. And in addition, you know, we're providing a screen, a state-of-the-art screen, and all we're asking is that you pay to install it. And certainly answer any of the questions that you have.
You just mentioned that your price has never changed, while the ZE price, GE price continues to drop. What about the technical standards? Are they the same today as they were when you first came in?
They are. Our claims, our permeability, our flow is the very same from August. You know, the challenge that I struggle with is how you can get 3.5 NGD through the C cassettes, and I think that's been brought up. And all we would ask is that if, in fact, that claim is made, that you have the same flow data. We provided 2 years of flow data on our technology.
You were required to do that.
That's correct. Any other questions that I can answer?
What do you estimate the installation of this drone screen?
On a time frame?
Well, a time frame and cost.
Well, the cost of $140,000 for the installation of the drone screen is a complete cost. It includes the rebuild of two JNA band screens. While we take the two band screens offline and we install the new one, we have in that price a skid-mounted temporary screen that will be put in place to screen the wastewater coming into the facility wide. We rebuild the two JNAs and put the new screen in place. So all of that's been consumed. We've had a contractor on site. Yeah, our price is a firm price. Any other questions I can help you? Thank you.
Mr. Chairman and Council, thank you for your time.
Who are you?
I'm sorry. Jim Emery. I'm the Global Lifecycle Services Manager for GE Water for the equipment division. I've been with the organization 28 years, originally a Xenon employee. I'd like to help clarify a few things. And I'd like to thank Nick for having put together the table. I know that it is a tough chore, and it was good to see that it got all together. So first of all, the 500C technology is not an antiquated 17-year-old technology. It is state-of-the-art. It has our newest flow chemistry, okay, the most permeable membrane that we've ever made. It has the newest urethane technologies in it. Every time we advance our technologies, we take those advancements back to our retrofit technologies.
Can you hold on for a second? Gentlemen. Disruption, please. Show the man to respect that.
Thank you. So every time we make an advancement, we look for a way to take it back and improve our previous products. And we offer our customers the ability to either use that original product or our newest products. For example, a 500D Energy CS1 cassette that allows us then to get even additional benefits around the original. One of the things that we offered in our proposal most recently was to ensure that in a 500C situation, we would convert the plant to a 1030 aeration, which is a patented aeration technology, that would save you 40% of energy. Now, I understand that at this time, that's not a benefit to the county, but in the long term, would be. If we went to the 500D with LEAP, there's an additional 40% savings on top of that with that new aeration technology. Okay. There were some questions about, when do you invest in new technology? Do you invest in new technology long before you need it? And if you don't need an iPad at home, do you buy one today or do you wait till the new iPad comes out? Because the reality is, we are doing a significant amount of investment. The 500E got mentioned, I love that. I love how that just came up. I mean, that's a brainchild. That is at the very earliest stages of toll gate one in the development. GE takes their research and development very, very seriously. So that product over the next 5 to 6 years will evolve, will come out and be piloted, be trialed, and finally released. That could be 5 to 7 years from now, difficult to say. But for sure, this facility would have the opportunity to benefit from that. So don't lock yourself in and think that you're going to buy something now and you're not going to be able to get to the next version. That's not what's going to happen. So thinking about 3.5 MGD maybe isn't the right thing to do when you're thinking about today's investment. 3.5 MGD is something you're going to get to probably in 8 to 12 years based on growth in the region. One of the things that I would like to point out is we are kind of the original MBR company. We manufacture our own membrane, we do our own development, we're not a reseller. When you deal with GE, you deal with General Electric.
And where's your office?
My office? I'm actually out of Toronto. Our head facility is in Philadelphia. Actually, Trevo's, Pennsylvania is our worldwide headquarters for GE Park.
The old Xenon company that supplied?
The original Xenon company remains out of Oakville with staff across the world.
Oakville, it's just outside Toronto.
About 40 minutes.
How hard is it to interchange like bases 3 and 4 use D's and bases 1 and 2 still use C's?
Yeah.
Is that possible?
Absolutely. We'll put some control valves on the aeration, and that's really probably the biggest issue that we'll have to step up and take care of.
How do we address the letter from our operator that says that then, even if the current membrane vendor was used for phases 3 and 4 alone, the technology would be different than the existing membranes and operational issues would ensue? How do we discount what the operator, the guy in the field, the guy on the street is talking about versus you trying to say, I'm in sales too, so trust me, I'm not trying to beat you up here. But
I'm actually not in sales, I'm a technical guy. Okay. I'm responsible for aftermarket.
So I'm just wondering how we discount what the operator here in Forsyth County says versus what you're doing.
Yeah, one of the things that's great about the design here is that the permeating pumps are specific for a train. The ability to operate that train at the design flow rate is very simple for us to control with the PLC. You don't need a new PLC, you don't need new input cards, you're simply going to write some new code to be able to do that. One of the things that
I... Excuse me, writing new code? It's not existing?
No, we will write some additional rungs of code into the PLC program. Yeah, we have that coded. It will have to be imported into your PLC. One of the things that, and maybe this, Patrick, will tie back to one of your other questions. And you made the question about we sold 8 membranes, we could have sold them 6. When you're selling an individual element, okay, an individual element is going to go into that facility and it's going to operate with a bunch of other membranes that are 8 years old. You're going to get preferential flow through that new element. I don't care if it's ours or anyone else's. The new membrane makes a lot of water and bounce faster. So what you need to do when you're doing individual element replacements is you need to be more conservative. You can't use what the design flux for a new train of membranes. Okay? On a whole new train of membranes, we'll be able to operate it, but what at the design flux they want to operate at based on the control system and the variable.
Well, that's a good point. Do you have flow data that will substantiate
with
the new flow
is
on these
things? Yeah, we have no problem. We have hundreds of plants and quite a number of large ones in operation now with our new, with this new flow chemistry. Okay. I think one of the challenges that we had, and I mentioned this when I was here previously, was that we had a couple of things going on last August when we first woke up. Okay. Number one was it wasn't the same scope. We had some back pulse tanks in that scope. We had some additional redesigned hangar arms for the 500C in that scope with are no longer in the scope. So some of those things cost pricing changes. Some errors on our part cost pricing changes.
So there's no competitive, really?
And you know, point number three would be there is a competitive situation here that has forced us to sharpen our pencil and make sure that you get the best deal that you can.
Who would know that in the future if there's not a competitor if we're locked into your technology?
I think for one thing, there's clearly our competitors. And we're certainly learning very quickly globally about those competitors, the capabilities, and where we need to be to win.
I think there's a lesson for us there too about having competitors.
Any other questions?
Ms. Kapoor, when we're going out for RFPs and such, and different people are bidding on doing work for us or selling a product or what have you, do we allow them to continue to lower their price and lower their price and lower their price until they're competitive?
We do a different process than I think any company. Our process is very defined. I go out, if it's a RFP, if it's a bid, it's a straight bid, give me your best price. If it's an RFP, which we usually would do on a technology like this, we look at the, we don't always look at the lowest cost, we look at the best solution, if you will, the best solution for our plant. That's how we came up with this federation at this point in time. And then we come to a point and say, give us your best price. We do not share costs with other people. People do not know what the other people are giving to us.
We don't do that.
Sometimes it might be at this. And I have to say that the biggest point or some of the points that stuck and didn't stick with well made and biggest point is once we lock in, what keeps you from really sticking in this in the future if you were up here to begin with and you only came down because you were forced to and not because you were giving us the best price to begin with and was honest to begin with?
We'd be comfortable locking that price in for 2 years. We'd do that.
This thing, and if it was longer than $1 million versus 504, you wouldn't need their half $1 million?
Oh, no.
You're not going to do that? No. Are you willing to lock in the $1,072,000?
Yes, sir.
This will be in 72 of proven technology.
Yes. And the opportunity for the advancements in the future to bring that price down for you. And the market price to bring that price down for you.
But the 500 C's have been around for 17 years, and I know that you've made improvements to the 500 C's. But in making three, it doesn't look like it came down when they were being phased out.
The 500 C's?
Yeah.
The 500 C's price is not as aggressive as the 500 D price. 500 D's, mass production. We make significantly more of them today than we use. That does create some price challenges.
Did you can you talk about the technology? So it's the same technology, just a different configuration.
Sure. Yeah. Afternoon, Sabigo, FLVivo, at Austin. We're the supplier of the flat plate membrane for Kubota. And just to give you a background on it, it's the same technology that we've always used with Kubota. Same core size, same membrane material. The only thing we've really done is we've reconfigured the packaging of it. So when you look at the technology, it's really 20 years old. It's been around since 1990 with the same materials. The only thing we've done again is reconfigure the unit so that, you know, we got a different slightly different assortment or array of how we put that unit together, but as far as the technology goes, it's been around for more than 20 years.
So the GE stuff is actually 3 years newer than yours?
I guess, you know.
I guess the material would be.
The material, yeah. Yeah, we're using the same materials that we've used. We just reconfigured the way the membrane, instead of being a long sheet, we've actually replaced the sheets with shorter panels that come in a module that really make for easier replacement of the unit. So that's why we did it. It fits in a shower or tank. It's really ideally set up really for the facility out of Fowler, and that's why it was developed.
When they were talking, you said that the configuration, I think it was maybe Nick, you talked about the $350 to replace up portion of a Kubota membrane versus 1,200 to 1,500 to replace a segment of the, is that
That's the numbers we have.
Okay. Yeah, that was the number we have for 350 per module. And we've, as John mentioned, we've got that tied to CPI index increase. So that's our guaranteed replacement cost. You know, that's kind of how we've set it up. So one of the reasons we've actually modified that unit is the replacement costs are a lot better than what the other units, the previous units had. That was one of the big advantages of it.
Any other vendors want to tell us something?
With Mo and I do have a question. I think, you know, we need to clarify. You know, what the concern of the staff, the county staff, was the issue of debris building up, like in the lower units, and you know, how do you address that? What's been your experience? You know, you've got your membranes are closer together. Is that an issue that?
Yeah, we don't see. Yeah, I guess we don't see an issue with the plate. The difference in the plate spacing is the plates that are out at James Creek, the older style, are 8 millimeter. These are 6 millimeter.
Apart.
Yeah, so we're talking 2 millimeter difference in the spacing, so it's fairly, I think, trivial. But the reason why we went with the tighter plate spacing is because we actually use a media bubble, more efficient airlift or oxygen transfer underneath the unit. So at that slightly smaller bubble size, the 6 millimeter plate spacing works very effective with that tighter, you know, with the smaller bubble that's coming up underneath it. So that was the primary reason to go with the slightly, you know, more tighter packing on the plate spacing more than anything else.
I seem to recall, and I don't remember if you were here or somebody else from Kubota, had offered to leave some type of a cleaning machine or something here, just to address that concern that you
put
this. Yeah. Well, I don't remember what it was. I just remember back. Is that still?
Yeah, we've got what we call our membrane treatment system. But if those membranes ever get fouled up, if they ever get sludged up, we've actually got an automated machine that the units and the modules can be pulled out in rows, put through this machine, and cleaned automatically.
And you'll still put that machine here?
Yeah. Well, where the plan was to locate it up at your facility. Know, and it'd be there for your use if you needed it. If it's needed somewhere else, it could be commissioned out there. But that was the idea behind that. And to my knowledge, I think we're probably the only ones that have that. I don't know of another supplier that actually has an automated system that can clean membranes like that. But I guess in regards to the screening issue, you know, all these membranes, no matter if it's ours, if it's the hollow fibers, you know, without good screening up front, you really run the risk of seeing those membranes get fouled up and damaged. You know, so we're all kind of in that same position. And as John mentioned in our proposal here, we put this screen, this demo screen that we're talking about, up at James Creek. And it's running very, very well. Much better than the band screen or the rotary drum screen that they have there right now. So we're very impressed with it. We got us the right fit. Whether we're talking the older style membranes that we have or the newer style, we think it's a great fit for either one, just on the nature of the screen itself. So I think we have a complete proposal for you.
Yeah, does it help you a little bit with the 5-year full warranty versus a 2-year?
Played it out.
Some of your concerns with
not really. I mean, I don't know if that was purchased. You can purchase a 5-year, 10-year full warranty with any of them. So we don't know what's in the purchase price if that was a buy. That's not the warranty they gave us when we bought them 3 years ago.
No, I'm saying so, the Kubota product is a 5-year warranty included in this price. Does that alleviate any concerns you might have as a full warranty versus a 2-year warranty?
And my luck with warranties are there's too many outs. If the screening goes bad, is that a warranty? Whose fault is that? And so as they're still, though, it's really the product itself, and if it's well operated, yes, it'd be good. I think there's too many other things at Fowler that could nullify any warranty. So
would it be better to have a 2-year warranty that they can wiggle out of, or a 5-year warranty? It seems like we'd have a better chance of recovery with 5 years. We'd have 5 years to argue with them versus 2 years.
And then the two-year warranty works before, it's a good point. I mean, 2 to 5, I don't know what the cost is. I don't know what the cost would be if I get a 5 to 10 year warranty with any of them.
With what you've learned in from there, and they clarify some of these, again, if it were our plan, which it is, and it will be, do you still think that the 500D conversion is superior to the Kubota? And it's $1 million more, or do we still not willing to take that risk?
Our recommendation in the review was all along the 500D. I'll admit the low future membrane replacement cost. If we knew we would go with either one of these technologies in 10 years and not do something else, that would be enticing. There are other products out there that, you know, we don't know what future membrane we'll use, so that's why we kind of backed off this in 10 years.
Both of just
right.
Mr. Merritt, do you have anything to add? You've been helping with this a little bit.
Commissioner, it's obviously a very difficult choice. It's at some points, it's almost a toss-up. I feel like that this is more appropriate for water and sewer to move forward on and really hear their recommendations.
Okay.
Which I would love to hear.
Our recommendation to AECOM would have been to replace the phases 3 and 4 with the Xenon D membranes. At one time there was concern about mixing. I think they're past that. And then they can replace phases 1 and 2, which need to be replaced with their contribution of 450. That's their expense. They can replace those as needed. We thought we could take some of the good membranes and move them into train 1, and then they could buy new membranes with their remaining money, but that's their choice. Not do the screening. We didn't see the return benefit, even though it started to get there with the screening that was being put in there, and the opportunity to take advantage of that free screen. We were getting, you know, getting some real numbers, but all of the savings for the next 12 years are back to the operator of the facility, and we couldn't show you the savings unless we took the plant over and ran it ourselves. And because of that, and because we could change out technologies later, it's not to say we can't change to Kubota later. We don't know what the future prices will be. There are just too many ifs. The one other thing I wanted to mention in fairness, and John mentioned the price that they gave. That was after we invited them in and we shared with them Xenon's offer. And we also had them meet with AECOM to find out what they had budgeted for the membrane replacement. So it wasn't a bid, Commissioner Levant, that was out blindly. Both, you know, the Avivo people had some advanced numbers about what they might could offer to get this done. With our involvement, we did ask them to go meet with AECOM because there was a potential. We looked at you being able to expand the plants. We believe we could possibly expand the plant larger than with Xenon. And when that didn't happen, that's when we reversed back. We just, staff of several and had many meetings, we kept circling back to the same conclusion.
I'll ask you just the same thing that I asked the GDS. How do we discount what the operators, that's where they say that operational issues will ensue?
In our opinion, the operator of the facility is set to save millions, maybe of dollars, if we will help pay for a change out to Kubota. It takes away their risk. They will say whatever they need to say.
You're talking about saving money. It's just operational issues with us too.
Yeah. And so they're desperate to get us to change out, their opinion. And so we discount what they say.
That's our assumption. Not really.
We don't save money, they save money, don't they?
Correct.
Now, even the operator now met the minimum state standard, as you and I went out to that plant, I mean, it could have been run better, but as long as they meet minimum state standards, they can run it like they want to, can't they?
As long as they meet the state standards.
Yeah, so
and the contract.
And the contract.
But if they don't want to clean those membranes, they don't have to.
But if it's our asset that they're working on, we would certainly want to have the operator treated and run it in the best, most cleanest way possible. We certainly feel like to lease the car somebody.
Do we have any checks and balances on them now besides if they meet the state standard?
I don't know. All I have is a letter that says that mixed technology will create operational issues. And if it does, then we're going to notice.
Well, I'm like Tim. I'd kind of discount this with the letter, but they're working for them.
Well, we can discount it, but if there's a problem, we can just put on notice.
Tim, did you make a comment? I may have heard you wrong. Like you said, it was a non-profit that you anticipated increasing your capacity, but it didn't happen.
What I was trying to explain, one time we did not believe there was any expansion possible with the Xenon C membranes as far as trying to expand and not have to build a future expansion, put off a future capital expense. We thought that possibly a Vivo Kubota or the Xenon Ds could provide some savings from having to build something in 8 years. And so we were interested in getting away from the Xenon Cs. After we found that we had additional space in the membrane trains and the new filtration rate, it made them all equal again. So that's when we circled back and we couldn't see the real future cost avoidance by doing the change out now. We can do these things later.
Do we need phase 3 and 4 now?
That's a good question. We do have it built in, and Mr. Cooper mentioned the permitting. We believe the EPD will allow us to go ahead and go to the 2.5. During the wintertime, we have the seasonal discharge to Big Creek, and during the summertime, with Fowler Park and all the irrigation water, we think we can show them the reason to go ahead and expand the permit to the full 2.5. Like he said, just bringing back the Fulton County flow from the lower Big Creek pump station will get us close to 1.8. So if the EPD says no, we've still got the 1.8, but we need some redundancy, we need to back up. We have irrigation in the summer. We may not be able to do it year round, but we can turn off or turn on that pump back from Fulton County to match our permit. We can maximize it.
So we do need to go ahead and do phase 3 and 4.
We need to do 3 and 4.
Based on you're going to jump up to phase 3 and 4, phase 1 and 2 right now is a Xenon 500C, but I think I heard you say you'd recommend the Xenon 500D in what, phase 3 and 4?
Correct.
Or in all four phases?
And right now, we would just replace them in 3 and 4 and not spend any additional money.
And who would pay for phase 3 and 4?
That's already budgeted. That's the dollars you see there, that $946, that's already in the contract.
Hold on, let me.
No additional cost.
And so they would also additionally, would they change the Xenon 500C that's in phase 1 and 2, would they then also change that to the Xenon 500D in phase 1 and 2?
That'd be their choice.
So
hold that thought for just a second. Would you certainly want them to be the same, or would you not?
Well, we have to adjust our operation to have two different systems. If we take one tank out of service, or we try to move membranes around, they pretty much have to stay in for those two tanks. We can't move them anywhere. So, but there's no benefits in going to the newer generation that we're willing to accept at that.
Is this an additional cost to the county, and you feel that there's no benefit to justify the additional, because it costs you more, I guess. Is that correct?
We can't support replacing all the old membranes with new membranes of because all we have in our budget is the cost of media, to replace the media. But for a long time, we can deal with two tanks of a certain type and two tanks of another type. And if we had replaced the old 500Cs with other 500Cs, we would still be back. So we still run the system as two parallel systems.
Are we considering columns F and G at this point, if I'm looking at the screen? Would C and D not really be in there, or is it still part of the equation?
Commissioners, I think I would call it maybe column 2 starts with G, water, xenon, 500D. That column is what we are recommending, I understand. And just to summarize that, that means that the county has already contributed about $942,000, so it's no additional cost to the county to add the membranes in basins 3 and 4, and then the operators will come back and replace the bad performing, the replacement membranes in basins 1 and 2. That gives us 2.5 MGD of capacity, and we would not recommend expanding to 3.5 MGD at this time. I think that's a fair sum.
That's okay. And then say the 502,000 is up for sale?
Yes, sir.
And can you put 500 C's are currently in basins 1 and 2. As they fail, can you replace them with 500 C's or you change the whole basin?
Well, the way we operate, we'd have to replace them with 500 C's. We're not willing.
I see. So,
so either you
put 1 and 2 and 7 C's, these would be in 3 and 4.
We can't mix the two.
C's come out of that, 1 and 2 come out of their pocket.
Right. So 1 and 2 would stay 500
C's, and
D 3 and 4 would be D's.
Right. And we just run them 2 parallel systems, are all controlled by DLC. So.
And can you answer
the
question about how they say we shouldn't do that? Or is that again? I'm concerned about that.
We were concerned because it, you know, it's just like anything. Two uneven size or uneven operation systems. You know, one has more equalization than the other. If you lose a membrane in one, it's very hard. You have to, it's not as easy to put more flow out of the other. You have to reprogram it. You have to ramp up the permeate pump differently if you're using an extra membrane in tanks 1 and 2 versus that tanks 1 and 3, or 3 and 4. So it does take a little bit more effort. The cleaning is different, things like that. But you know, there's enough potential savings in power and potential for cleaning that. We're well in the day, we can offset it with power.
Do you think it's possible at this point? There's still a lot of uncertainty, yes, maybe on our part. Is it possible, do you know of an engineering firm that doesn't do business with AECOM or Kubota, that could analyze this relatively quickly and give us an unbiased recommendation? Because I have to tell you, everything that I see, if I were spending my money, I would spend the money to upgrade it to a new plant, the new technology, with a 5-year unlimited warranty, with a $500,000 replacement for 10 years, versus the 2 million with the 2-year. I'm having difficulty accepting that that's the way to go. And I'm wondering if there's a process that you could help with, that there's an engineering firm that nobody's ever used before. They can review this and be willing to get a recommendation, even if they had to pay them a small fee.
Yeah, I guess I thought that we were unbiased in the way we presented it. Obviously,
you've not given us a recommendation, so I can't say that you're unbiased or biased because you've not said which one you would go with.
Right.
Well, he's on his paper. We're going to save $500,000 if we just replace 3 and 4. Mm-hmm. It's pure fact.
Where do you see that?
Cost
of, you mean if we don't have to?
If we just replace, if we go 500D, we're going to save $500,000.
Right. But he also said that we will never see cost again this low to do a full conversion to new technology. So you have to weigh the benefit of do we spend a little bit of money now and grab the benefit of their $946,000 that they're going to contribute plus the 540, excuse me, the 450. You got to, you know, yes, the dollar is more, but it's the benefit.
When do we get to 3.5 million?
The estimation is we'll leave it at by 2020.
Can we before we are? Are you going to vote to postpone that?
Yes.
Yes.
I don't know.
I, you know, what I see is a consistent view from our county staff, who I feel has looked into this and is as unbiased as anybody can be. So my question is, what is it that the board needs to do here other than postpone?
Well, Jim, I'm not, again, if this were your money and you had the opportunity to transition your manufacturing facility to a brand new facility for a very little bit of money, would you not go ahead and jump at the opportunity because we've got some assets to contribute? $1.4 million. I still believe there's more to this than what we're getting. For example, the capacity of the 500 C's and D's, Tim said he's known for months. We didn't know about it until days ago at the last work session. So I'm concerned. We learned last night at 6 o'clock that our biology would limit some of this.
I mean, but you keep saying the old tech. I mean, we're going on proven technology.
I would say they're both.
But you talk about Kubota, look electric car. It ain't going real good. New technology. Do we stay with the old?
I'm not sure the comparison of a totally untested technology of the electric car versus a fuel injection over a 4-barrel Rochester. You got to look at reality speed, and you got to put things in perspective. Is a 4-barrel better than fuel injection? That would be an argument.
Currently, we can't take the flow from Lower Shallow. It's 1,000 a day, and then every day after August,
we need to make a decision.
15th, it's another 1,250.
I'm going to simply let
Mr. Chairman, we have a motion on the table. Mr. Chairman, we have a motion on the table.
I'll second this moment.
I'm sorry.
Well, it just didn't need to be, you need to die.
No, you're right.
See, sorry. Did you second?
He seconded.
Okay. We have a motion and a second. If there's no further.
Is that the appropriate thing to do? Would you think that we need to make a decision?
I did.
We're notorious for postponing right here, but.
We is it okay?
Make another decision, yes, sir. Right. Is 2 weeks okay?
No. I don't know.
Well, we've been listening to discussion, and we've been
putting this off.
Well, that's because of silly analogies that are being presented to confuse the issues. Tim, what would you prefer we do? Postpone the discussion?
I don't believe you can make a decision.
No, would you prefer us to make a decision tonight, one way or the other, or postpone it?
I would prefer, and I believe the operators would prefer to make a decision one way or the other. Because I think
that's what we need to do. Then let's make a decision.
Let's vote against the motion.
We have a motion and a second.
I'm going to withdraw my second on that.
We have a motion.
Yep.
I believe that the motion died for lack of a second or withdrawn second. I would make a motion that we approve the recommendation of staff, although I'm not sure I can articulate it the way that they would like it articulated. Tim, can you?
From what I heard from my ECOM, my recommendation would be to allow them to move forward with the purchase of the membrane cassettes for phases 3 and 4 using Xenon D500D technology.
That is my motion.
Second.
Tim, motion.
Will there be an acquisitions contract that will come back to that at some point, Don?
No, that's already written into our agreement.
Thank you.
I believe we have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion.
Wow. Staff recommendation?
I mean,
I don't think y'all understood that.
We have a wrong button.
I hit wrong button.
We have a wrong button, and we need to clear the board and revote.
Yeah, I'm sorry. I reached the wrong arm and died.
Okay, we have a motion to accept staff recommendation, which Tim just articulated, and we have a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes 3-2. Thank you, everyone, for coming.
Just to note, I did not hear a Thompson's development to that, which means it will have to go on the next new business agenda on January 1st, I believe.
All right. We are on to item number 18, which I believe was not postponed.
Mr. Chairman, I can handle this very quickly.
may recall that some time ago, I had presented at a, I think it was actually a regular meeting, we had done a very quick local option sales tax overview, and I have the same PowerPoint up here. I promise you I'm not going to bore you by going through all the elements of loss again. This is on the agenda for more of a reminder and maybe some direction. As you know, then the city of Cumming may trigger the negotiations on their own. In other words, it's not just us that can trigger them, it's the city of Cumming. We just have the first bite at the apple until July 1st. The deadline for completion of the negotiations is December.